The speed of light in a vacuum is the ultimate speed limit. It's the limit on relative speed that nothing can locally exceed. Sure, you could write down a speed that is larger than the speed of light, but it would be like writing a temperature lower than absolute zero. So, what makes the speed of light so limiting? Is there something deeper at play, embedded in the very fabric of reality? Let's find out. To understand this ultimate speed limit, we turn to Einstein's special theory of relativity. It rests on two key ideas. That is explained here with two observers, Alice and Bob. Alice is on a train moving at a uniform velocity v relative to Bob, who is standing on the ground. As they experience no acceleration, reference frames in which they are at rest are inertial frames. The first concept states that the laws of physics are the same for both of them. It is called the principle of relativity. This means that any experiment such as measuring relative velocity will yield the same results for both Bob and Alice. The second concept says that despite their relative motion, the speed of light remains the same for both. For instance, both Alice and Bob would measure the speed of light from the train's headlight to be c. This defies Newtonian concept of relative velocity, fundamentally changing our understanding of space and time. And that is what sets the ultimate speed limit for all physical entities. Let's explore how. Consider a laser on the train car's floor with a mirror fixed directly above it on the ceiling. When turned on, the laser emits a beam that travels up, reflects off the mirror, and returns to its starting point. The time interval measured by Alice between emission and return is simply twice the height divided by c, as the beam moves vertically at speed c in her frame. However, to Bob, the train moves as the beam travels, making its actual path longer. Since the speed of light for Bob is still c, he must therefore record a longer time interval than Alice. If the laser and mirror were fixed in Bob's frame instead, the principle of relativity ensures that Alice would record longer time than Bob. This reveals that moving clocks run slow, a phenomenon known as time dilation. Thus, time is not absolute, but depends on an observer's motion. It is a consequence of the constancy of the speed of light. Notably, the time interval measured by a clock with respect to which both the events occur at the same position is called the proper time. It is the shortest measured duration between two events. Now, let's examine space. Consider two events. The passing of both the ends of a ruler at rest in the train car across Bob on the ground. Alice's clocks measure the time between these events as dta, while Bob's clock measures it as dtb. The principle of relativity ensures that both measure the same relative velocity v. Thus, the train's length as recorded by Alice and Bob are simply products of respective time intervals and relative velocity. These events occur at the same position in Bob's frame, so his time is the proper time. Therefore, using the appropriate time dilation relation, we find that Bob measures a shorter ruler length than Alice. Thus, moving objects contract, a phenomenon known as length contraction. This demonstrates that spatial distances, like time, depend on the observer's motion. The equations for time dilation and length contraction show two important consequences. As the train speed approaches c, Bob sees that its length shrinks to zero in the direction of motion and its clocks slow to a stop. Thus, at the speed of light relative to an observer, a three-dimensional object like the train would become two-dimensional with no volume and frozen in time. However, these are impossible for anything with mass, as such objects must have finite volume and an internal clock that ticks. At even greater speed, the length contraction and time dilation yield imaginary numbers. That's obviously meaningless, as meter sticks and clocks can only define real valued coordinates. All this implies that no object can ever reach or breach the speed of light relative to any other object. Energy requirements also forbid exceeding the speed of light. The energy of an object grows infinitely large as its speed approaches c. Therefore, even with all the energy in the universe, accelerating a massive object to c is impossible. Only massless particles like photons can travel at c, since for m equals 0, the equation naturally gives v over c as 1. In summary, a universal speed limit exists because time slows to a stop, space contracts to zero size, and energy becomes infinite when something approaches the speed of light. These pathological effects make it fundamentally impossible for a massive object to reach the speed of light. But who knows, maybe one day, a new breakthrough like a traversable wormhole will enable us to bypass the speed limit without locally breaking it. Until then, we'll have to keep going at sub-light speeds.